Very good morning, everyone. And I think today the weather has become a little pleasant compared to yesterday, because yesterday night it rained very heavily here. And I'm going to start my presentation on how the ear encodes the head movement, how the head movements are exactly encoded by our vestibular system. So this is our inner ear. And rather than whenever I describe my patient, I don't say that they have a vestibular disorder. I tell that they have an inner ear disorder, because it is the both are the part of the same system. Here all we know that this is a structure. I am not interested here. I am interested for this. That is nothing but if we look into the length of this canal, that is the three semicircular canal, only it is in some mm, that is 15 to 20 mm or 18 to 12 mm or 12 to 15 mm. That is the total length. And what is the diameter is only 0.8 mm. That means to say that these are very narrow canals, or these are very narrow channels where the fluid is not going to move so easily with each and every stimulus which is there. So what happens here is something like when we give a sound stimulus, the ear is not going to, I mean the vestibular system basically is not going to respond to the sound stimulus. That is how we live so happily in this world otherwise. If there is a sound and every time the sound is going and stimulating our vestibular system, it will create a problem. So this is what is important, the length and the diameter which is there. The second most, the important thing is this, that is the three semicircular canal, the ampulla of the three semicircular canal and the macula of the two otolith organs, and the structures here, it is cupola and this is the macula, where we see this otocornea, the basically the calcium carbonate particle. And this calcium carbonate particle, because these are heavy particles, okay, this make the utricle and saccule basically a bioaccelerometer, or it makes the utricle and saccule sensitive to the gravity. Okay, and I'm coming in little detail. Now, this is the hair cells which are there. So here we look into the hair cells which are there in the utricle or saccular macula, and this is the hair cells which are over here in the cupola. So here the hair cells, there are two types, type 1 and type 2. It is very much identical to our outer hair cells and the inner hair cells. This is basically like the inner hair cells and this is like the outer hair cells. What is important is this stereocilias. So now the longest of the stereocilia is the kinocilium, and this all the stereocilias are connected with each other with the help of the what is known as the tip link. Tip link are basically a mechanical kind of a door where it, when it opens, it allows the ions to go inside the hair cells, and then the action potentials are generated over here. So here, what is happening here is that this is the direction of the excitatory, that is the depolarization, nothing but if the hair cells or the stereocilias are moving towards the kinocilium, it leads to a depolarization in the system, whereas when the kinocilium moves towards this smaller stereocilias, basically it leads to a hyperpolarization. That means say that either there is an increase in action potential or there is a decrease in action potentials over here. But what is important is this, that is nothing but whenever there is no stimulus, that means say that when my head is not moving or when I am not moving, is there some amount of action potentials which are there in the neurons, that is the vestibular neurons. If we look into this, this is the phase of the depolarization and this is the phase of the hyperpolarization. So the during the depolarization phase, there is an increased frequency, that is the increase in number of the action potential, and during the hyperpolarization, there is a decreased frequency. Okay, and but what is happening is when it is at rest, that means say that the head is not moving when it is at rest, at that point also what happens is some of these tip links are partially opened, it is not completely closed. So this is partially open, and at rest also when my head is not moving, there are some amount of action potentials which are always there in the vestibular neurons. It is there in the vestibular neuron. And what we have to understand is that the spontaneous rate of hair cells of the semicircular canal in mammals is around 80 to 90 spikes per second. So you can imagine that 80 to 90 spikes per second is a spontaneous. So when there is a phase of a depolarization, how much more it is going to happen. So that may say that at resting also, we have some amount of action potential which is going on in the neurons. And this is law of inertia, which we have learned probably from class 6th, 7th. Newton said that yes, if we keep an object, it is going to be there. Now what is happening here is, how this is the two semicircular canal. This is the two lateral semicircular canal which I am going to describe. How they are encoding the head movement, basically how they are responding to the head movement is. Now what we have to understand is the orientation of the kinocelium on this side and the orientation of the kinocelium on this side. If we look into this, the orientation of the kinocelium in this lateral canal is, or this lateral canal is towards the ground. So it is like this in this also, and it is in this also. Now, when the head, we are moving the head to this side, that is the right side, what will happen is the head is having its own inertia, the fluid is having its own inertia. So when the head moves, the fluid basically doesn't catch up with the speed of the head. It is something like we take a glass of cool drinks, we put some ice cube there and we try to when rotate it, initially it doesn't catch up that speed, and when we just rotate little more, then it is going to catch up that speed. That is where it is going. Because of the inertia, it doesn't catch up that speed. Because of which, if the head is moving on this side, that is towards the right side, the flow of the endolymph is towards the opposite side. When it is moving to the opposite side, it is basically deflecting this stereocilius towards the kinocelium, and hence what happens that there is a depolarization on the right side. So if I'm moving my head to the right side, there is basically a depolarization on that side. But what happens towards the left side? Now what happens towards the left side is the flow of the endolymph is going to be to, in the opposite direction, and here what will happen is the kinocelium will push the smaller stereocilius towards this side, and hence there is going to be a hyperpolarization here. That means say when I am moving my head to the right side, there is a depolarization, and when I am moving my head to right side, there is a depolarization on the right and there is a hyperpolarization on the left side. So this is with the head movement how it is going to encode it. And this is the basis of the entire vestibular ocular reflex, wherein if I am moving my head to the right side, the eyes are supposed to move to the left side. So I move my head to the right and the eyes will go to the left side, that is towards the opposite side. And that is how the image is basically getting stabilized with the head movement. We don't find that the image is moving in my visual field with my head movement. Now, this is another thing which we have to understand is this. Now, all the semicircular canal, whether it is lateral semicircular canal or anterior or the posterior semicircular canal, they are like a ring. So they are like a semicircle, they are like a ring. Now, what happens that whenever there is a fluid movement, the fluid can move in this way or the fluid can move in this way. That is, it is going to move in this way or it is going to move in this way. Now, if I make this to move like this, that is if it is fluid is moving like this, so if I move like circle like this, the fluid is going to move in this direction, fluid is going to move in this direction. But same thing if I am just moving up and down, this is not going to get deflected or this is not going to move there. Hence, each of these canals are sensitive in their own planes. That is, the lateral canal is sensitive in the lateral plane, whereas the vertical canals are sensitive in the vertical planes only. So if I have the two lateral canals, they get depolarized or hyperpolarized basically in the lateral plane, and they don't get depolarized or hyperpolarized in my vertical plane. So the two lateral canals are sensitive in the two lateral planes, and the vertical canals are sensitive in the vertical planes. But what is happening here in the, because of this semicircular canal structures, when I'm moving my head, when I move my head, now all of us had the habit in the childhood that we take a round, 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 and we turn around. Now here, how the head is coding, encoding such kind of sustained movement, now when there is no turning, there is no sensation. So this is, the cupola is not getting deflected, the fluid is not moving to any side, and hence we don't find any sensation. The moment we start the turn, the cupola is deflected here. And that is where we start feeling that everything has started rotating. But when we are moving further with a constant speed, what happens that the head, basically the head velocity and the endolymphatic velocity, that is endolymph velocity, they become constant. So again, what happens that this deflection will become no deflection over here. But suddenly when we stop, but we stop, our body stops, but the endolymph which was moving, it doesn't stop at that point of the time. So what will happen is, because this doesn't stop, again what happens is, once we stop after turning, we feel that everything has just started rotating around us. Okay? So this is how the sustained head movements are encoded by the semicircular canals. And the three semicircular canals basically they are working in three planes, that is the yaw plane, the roll plane, and the pitch plane. And this is the best it can be described, that if I can fix my head from here, it can only move in this plane, and this is the lateral plane. If I can fix by this way, it moves in this way, or if I can put a here, this can only move in this way. These are the three planes where the three semicircular canals are basically working, or they are working in their own plane. Any point of the time we forget, we have to remember the plane landing basically. So this is the yaw plane, that is the lateral canal is in the yaw plane, and the anterior canal is the roll plane, and the posterior canal, it is the pitch plane. Pitch plane is nothing but, we have to remember that, the flight landing or the flight taking up. This is the pitch plane basically. So this is what is the coded by your posterior canal. Now, this is the functional connection between the two side semicircular canal. It is not a structural connection. The two are not connected by any kind of a structure. These are only connected functionally. So here what is happening is there are three planes. That is, the two lateral planes are connected with each other. Right anterior is connected to the left posterior, and left anterior is connected to the right posterior. Hence, it becomes lateral plane, the RAL plane, and the LAR plane. That is, in the right lateral, when there is a depolarization, there is going to be a hyperpolarization in the left lateral. And when there is a depolarization in the left anterior, there is going to be hyperpolarization on the right posterior. So this is how the semicircular canal is encoding these different head movements. Now, here which we have to remember is, the semicircular canals are not sensitive to gravity. Rather than, it is only sensitive to the angular accelerations. That's it. It is not going to this one. Second, now why it is not sensitive to gravity is because the weight, approximate weight of the cupula and the approximate weight of the surrounding endolymph, that is the gravity basically, both are almost same. That is, the endolymph and crista is about 1 gram per milliliter. Because of this, what will happen is, the cupula is only going to move whenever there is an endolymphatic movement because of the head movement. So if we suddenly say that we sleep, it is not going to just go down in any direction. It will only move when it is moving in the plane because of this gravity. Hence, the crista moves only with the head movement, and it doesn't move in any direction because of any other movement. Now, the restoration of the cupula to its original place. So once say that I have moved my head completely to this side, there is going to be a depolarization on this side, or there is going to be hyperpolarization on the opposite side. The time the cupula takes back to return to its original place is roughly around 6 to 7 seconds, and it reaches to about 63% of its original place from where it is, it had deflected back. And the rotational VOR, that is nothing but when my head is moving in the different direction or the different planes of the semicircular canal, okay, and that has been estimated, reported to be roughly around 7 to 15 milliseconds. That means that the total time taken for the vestibular system to get depolarized and hyperpolarized, and the vestibulo-ocular reflex system to start the process, that is roughly around 7 to 15 milliseconds, and no other sensory mechanism which is faster than this over there for the eye movement or the compensating eye movement. Now, the second part which is there, it's encoded by the head movement, is encoded by the utricle and the saccule. Now, here if we look into the utricle and the saccular macula, this is the utricular macula and this is the saccular macula. That means say that utricular macula is there in the horizontal plane and the saccular macula is there in the vertical plane. However, it is not exactly vertical or it is not exactly horizontal. Okay, this I'm just showing the another picture there. Now here what is happening is, in both the utricular macula or the saccular macula, these stereocilias are embedded within a globular substance which is nothing but, it is made of glycoprotein and I don't know how to pronounce it anyway. And this is basically a kind of a jelly mass. It is a kind of like a jelly mass. Now on this jelly, top of the mass, there is this photocornea which is there, and there is a portion where the amount of photocorneas are very less. This portion is called as a striola, and from the striola, the direction of this stereocilia basically changes on the opposite direction. Now here what is important is that otolith have a higher density than the endolymph, and that makes the otolith become sensitive to the gravity basically. So they become sensitive to the gravity. Now here This is what I was telling, that the saccule or the utricular macula are not exactly horizontal or vertical. If you look into that, they are curved in between, and hence they also respond in different direction, not only the vertical plane or not only the horizontal plane. So they respond in different direction, but overall we have to remember is the orientation of the saccule plane is in the vertical and the orientation of the utricular plane is in the horizontal direction. Now this is what happens, that is a tilt and acceleration. When the head has a tilt to the forward or the backward side, or there is an acceleration. So what happens is there is going to be a movement of the utricular macula over here. Okay. So now here what will happen is, the problem is that if you can look into the tilt and the acceleration, there is same kind of movement which happens here in both the tilt and acceleration, and hence the utricular macula cannot differentiate between a tilt and acceleration which is happening over there. Okay. Now, however, what we have to remember is, how much ever is the tilt, that means say that if I'm moving my body by 1 degree, 2 degree, 3 degree, 4 degree, 5 degree, there is an equal amount of the deflection of the utricular macula or the saccular macula. Okay. That doesn't mean that if I move my head by 1 degree, this is going to get deflected by 5 degree. No. There is going to be an equal amount of shift which is going to happen over there. Okay. So now, this is the same thing, that is nothing but these otolith organs are basically a bioaccelerometer, and they are very sensitive to the gravity. Okay. Now, this is what another thing which we have to remember is, nothing but if we understand that if this is the macula, now the macula can the shift in different plane according to the different head movement. So the macula can be here, the macula can move in this direction, or it can move in this direction. But what we have to remember is, the center of the gravitational force is the same across all the head movements. So this is always directed towards gravity. There will be an independent movement of this stereocilius according to the different head movement, but it is going to maintain the gravity to the center itself. Okay, it is not going, or this arrow is not going to shift in different direction with this kind of a movement which is happening there. Okay. And again, very simple, we have to remember that we have three semicircular canal, we have three movement of semicircular canal, we have three head movements, and we have three otolith movements, and we also have three semicircular canal movements, and we have only three types of neck movement which is going to happen. There are three planes of this translational VOR. One is heave, bob, and surge. Heave is nothing but moving to this side, to this side, and the surge is moving in the front plane and the back plane, and the bob is up and down. So these are the three planes in which the saccule and the utricle are responding. Okay, and this entire, the semicircular canal and the otolith organs makes the entire this one, and I say that the vestibular system is an internal GPS for the body. It is an internal GPS for the body. So where my body is, how my head is moving, this is all by the vestibular system. Thank you.